Welcome, ladies and gents, to episode 007 of the CPA Guide Podcast. I am your host, Brian Kessler. All right, well, that wasn't as smooth as I was hoping, but who can blame me for trying? So today, I want to start with a quote from one of my favorite fictional characters, Rocky Balboa. It ain't about how hard you can hit. It's about how hard you can get hit. It's how much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. So I really think that this quote sets the tone for today's episode. Today's episode, I have a guest on my show. His name is Dr. Greg Carnes, who is the Dean of the College of Business at the University of North Alabama. So Greg is not only the dean, but also works directly with Wiley CPAexcel to keep their regulation materials up to date. To do this, he not only writes the materials included into their course, but is also the star of their regulation video lectures. So I get to quiz Greg on several topics that I think are very crucial to today's accounting students and young professionals, and get his take on studying for the CPA exam, finding the best route for you in the accounting industry, whether you are still a student in college or someone who has been in the workplace for a few years. Not only do you get to hear some great advice from Greg, but at the end of this episode, you will also have an opportunity to sign up for another scholarship review course giveaway, which is of one copy of the video gold medal review course from Wiley CPAexcel. So you can either stay tuned to the end of this episode to find out how to register, or you can go directly to my show notes now to sign up at www.thecpaguide.com/session007.html. So on my show notes, you will find all the relevant links to all the items we mentioned during our interview and a summary of the key topics that we discussed, and also the registration details for this particular scholarship giveaway. So I hope that you can stick with us through this awesome episode.
The CPA Guide.
TheCPAGuide.com.
Let's learn how to dominate.
Dominate.
The CPA exam together. And here is your host and CPA Guide, Brian Kessler. Because if he can pass the CPA exam, anyone can.
All right, welcome everybody. I am very excited to be able to have Dr. Greg Carnes with us today. Dr. Carnes, he received his PhD from Georgia State University and was the department chair of accountancy at Northern Illinois University. So yeah, now today is the Dean of College of Business at University of North Alabama. If you've attended University of North Alabama Business School, you have more than likely been in one of his taxation classes. And in addition to teaching, Greg has been working closely with Wiley CPAexcel and helping to write their regulation materials. So Dr. Carn has a wealth of knowledge about regulation, and I'm hoping that he can share some awesome tips for us all to implement in our studying and to learn from his many years of experience as an educator. So thank you so much for being on the show, Dr. Carnes.
Yeah, Brian, thanks for having me today. I look forward to the discussion.
Absolutely. So I don't know, Greg, maybe just give us a bit of background about how you got started working with Wiley CPAexcel.
Yeah, my involvement started through one of the individuals, faculty members, who's been with CPAexcel from day one, Dr. Don Tidrick, who does the auditing material. He started with CPAexcel when he was at University of Texas, and I hired him to come to Northern Illinois University when I was department chair of the Department of Accountancy there. And after he'd been there for, probably 2 or 3 years, they needed someone to take over the tax role. And he asked me if I would be interested in doing the tax material for CPAexcel. I was already doing the material for the Northern Illinois University CPA Review Program, which that university runs throughout the Chicagoland area. So I told him that it sounded like a good opportunity. So I got involved with them a little over 10 years ago.
Sure. Fascinating. Before you got to being Dean of Colleges of Business and so forth, maybe give us a little bit of background on your qualifications and how you got to be in that position.
Sure. I've always, when I went off to begin my collegiate studies at Lipscomb University, I knew I wanted to study accounting. My father was always in the accounting area during his professional life. He has a degree in accounting from the University of Tennessee at Knoxville. and really enjoyed accounting. And while I was working on my undergrad degree, I had the opportunity to work with a local firm in Nashville and did quite a bit of tax work. That was during my senior year of undergrad, and really enjoyed that. So I decided to instead of joining the workforce after undergrad, I decided to pursue my master's in taxation at University of Memphis. And after that, worked with what was Ernst & Whinney then, Ernst & Young now, for about 3 years before deciding I wanted to make academia a career. So I've always, from a academic perspective, I've always been in the accounting and the tax area. I've always taught tax. I helped start the Masters of Taxation program when I was at Northern Illinois University, which has been a very successful program there in the greater Chicagoland area. And I also write for the leading textbook that's used in undergraduate tax programs, do some tax seminars each year for the American Institute of CPAs. So it's just an area that I've always enjoyed. There's lots of opportunities there, and that led me to the opportunity to begin working with CPAexcel.
Excellent, excellent. Yeah, I actually got my master's in accounting with an auditing focus down at Southern Illinois University. Okay. So I'm sure you're familiar with them.
Yes.
So let's just discuss the CPA exam a little bit. So as you said, your focus is primarily on regulations. There's been a ton of changes over the years in reg, but maybe think back and what were some of the biggest struggles that you experienced while you were sitting for the CPA exam, and how did you overcome them?
Well, when I sat for the exam, it was a very different format. It was 2.5 days. You had to sit for all four parts at one time. If you you had to pass at least two parts to keep anything, and if you made below a 50 on any part, you weren't able to keep anything that you passed. So those requirements were there to ensure that when folks took the exam, the idea was that you would actually have to prepare for all four parts at the same time. Sure. That was a great challenge. You know, today's exam, where you can sit for a part at a time, the students today have an advantage in that they can focus on one part. However, I think the exam has also gotten tougher, so there's a trade-off there. The thing that I found to be the most challenging is just trying to make sure that when you actually go, the day that you go to set for the exam, to make sure that you're game ready, so to speak. It's like, you know, like an athlete preparing for a football game, or maybe a better analogy is a track athlete who's prepared, you know, all season, but they want to peak at that, you know, at that most important meet of the year. And so you have all this knowledge that you're trying to make sure that you understand, but you got to peak at the right time. And so it's a matter of being very well. In order to do that, you got to work very hard, but you also got to be very well organized.
Absolutely. Yeah, and for me, my focus was all on auditing. So when I went to go sit for regulation, the materials that I studied, that was pretty much my all the knowledge about regulation was learned from those materials. So I think that's with the split focus between auditing and tax, you're always going to have one section where you're going to have a lot more knowledge from college, whereas the other you probably won't have nearly as much.
Yeah, that's true. And most folks who are studying for the exam are in the workforce. They, you know, some students will be able to take a part or so while they're still finishing up their collegiate studies, but most are in the workforce, and as you said, you're going to be working in a particular field most of the time, and so that does present the area. If you're working in auditing full time, you're not being exposed to tax, and you know the CPA exam is still an academic exam, and then so the closer sure. students can take that to the end of their academic coursework, the better off they're going to be.
Sure. Well, and you know, I run a blog, so I get emails all the time from people who are 15, 20 years into their careers, and then they realize that they need to get the CPA if they're going to ever advance within their company. So what kind of suggestions do you have for those types of people?
Well, for someone who has been out of school for a long time and they've decided now to get the exam, they may have an accounting undergraduate degree. And the same, your question would also apply to someone who has a degree that's not in accounting, and now they've decided that they want to want to change careers or sort of add an additional credential to their resume by getting the CPA. And if you meet all the requirements in your state to set for the exam, then you have to, what you need is an excellent review course, because there's so much information out there to try to that could potentially be tested. And when I'm teaching the review course, I always point out to students that with the if I taught them everything that could possibly be tested just in the tax portion of regulation, the amount of study time they would have would not be manageable. So what I'm really trying to do in the materials is I'm trying to narrow the scope down to about the 90% that I think is most likely to be tested. And that actually cuts the material down, trims the material down by probably, you know, even more than half, because, you know, it is highly predictable, you know, what's going to be tested probably about 90% of the time. And so so the trick is to get a necessity is to get a great review course where there are folks who are experts in those fields have prepared the information to help you focus on what you need to know to pass the exam. If you decide you want to set for the CPA exam, you don't yet meet the requirements that in the state that you need to set in, because that probably means you need to go back and get some additional academic credits. And in doing that, there's various ways to do that. You could go back to a university that's near you where you can take face-to-face classes. At the University of North Alabama, we've actually created what we call the Professional Accounting Prep Program, which has 24 hours of coursework. That's 8 3-credit-hour courses that cover the information that is tested on the CPA exam, so someone can actually earn academic credit while they're learning that knowledge that's going to be tested on the exam.
Interesting. For any students who aren't, or listeners who aren't familiar with this program, can anybody sign up for it, or do you have to be on site at the University of North Alabama to take these classes?
It's an online program, so it can be taken from any location. Matter of fact, over half of the students who take courses from us are in foreign countries. We actually started the program just with my tax course, because when individuals who are not U.S. citizens decide they want to pass the CPA exam, every state has a requirement for a tax course, requires that be a tax course based on the United States tax law, which those individuals would not have. So first we created the online tax course and ran just that course for about 3 years. But a lot of students, when they finished that course, began asking us whether or not, you know, we had other courses they could take. So we realized there was demand for that. And we had partnered with CPAexcel when we set the program up by licensing their content to use as the textbook for the course, so to speak. So we went back to CPAexcel to see if we could license content in the other areas, and that worked out. And so, yeah, you can do it from we have folks all over the world who are taking these courses.
Sure. Oh, and Greg, I wanted to mention that for anybody interested to find more about the University of North Alabama online prep classes for course credit, you can find links to their website in my show notes, which you can find at thecpaguide.com/session007.html.
With the University of North Alabama Professional Accounting Prep Program, a couple of things I want to point out about that program. As Brian mentioned, you can link to that from the CPAexcel website. If you go to CPA Resources, and then there's a link for earning university accounting credits. You can also access it by coming to the University of North Alabama homepage. But I wanted to mention that these courses are, these are 4-credit courses, and we are a regionally accredited university by SACS. So the courses will appear on a UNA transcript, you know, 3-credit hours. The courses are managed by UNA full-time faculty. So while we've licensed the material from CPAexcel, it's the faculty at UNA who have designed the syllabus, designed the curriculum. They've created the exams and quizzes and the homework points that you'll earn as you go through the material. Also, these the courses are very affordable, and so you can do a 3-credit hour course for $475, and that includes all the materials. And that's one thing, any student knows how expensive textbooks are today. And so to be able to earn a 3 hours of credit in a very high quality accounting course, including your materials for $475 is I think a great value. Students sometimes are paying, unfortunately, sometimes they're paying $300 or more for one textbook for one course these days. So for those who need some additional credits to be able to set for the CPA exam, I encourage them to check out the University of North Alabama Professional Accounting Prep Program.
That's great. So since it's taken directly from CPAexcel's review course, is this something that can take the place of a review course, or will after they graduate, will they still need to use some additional materials, or how does that work?
Well, how a student balances taking additional coursework versus taking using a CPA review course, each situation is really unique. So, for example, we have a lot of students who take courses in our prep program, and they only need, say, two courses in order to meet the requirements as set in their state. So they may take my advanced tax course and may take, say, a financial accounting 3 course, and then they've met the requirements. So clearly there, I think the best thing for them to do is actually buy a full review course that has all 4 parts that they can study it. We do have some who come and take all 8 classes from us. And for those students, they may not need to buy the whole review course, and they may be able to buy they can look to see what areas they feel they need the most assistance in. So even though they may have taken an auditing course through our prep program, they may feel like that they're still weak there, so they'd still want to buy the CPAexcel auditing review materials for the CPA exam. The other area that we don't cover in the prep program is actually most of the material that's covered in BEC, because that information tends to be more like economics, finance, information technology, those types of topics. And so that's an area where I think everyone, even if they've taken all the courses in our prep program, also would buy the materials for BEC.
Okay, no, that's very informative. All right, so one of the hardest things when I was sitting to take the CPA exam was finding the time to study plus work and then hang out with my wife or girlfriend. And so how do you suggest candidates juggle all these different aspects of their life while taking the CPA exam?
Well, I tell my students the first day of every semester, I tell, whether it's a sophomore level accounting principles course or it's a graduate level, in-depth, say, corporate taxation course, I tell them the same thing, which is that you have to study hard to do well in my courses, but you also have to study smart. And so, and a lot of times folks spend a whole lot more time in the studying process, whether for the CPA exam or an academic course, because they're just not studying smart. So let me give you a couple of examples when you're thinking about balancing your personal life and work and then trying to get ready for an exam of this magnitude. First of all, when you do study, you have to make sure that you're getting the most out of your study time that you possibly can. Once again, if you take a sports analogy, if you're trying to get in shape and you have 45 minutes to exercise, well, you can go to the gym and do a few exercises and talk to some other people there and kind of have a relaxed experience and you got something out of it, but you really weren't maximizing the calories you could burn in that 45 minutes. It's the same way with studying. Sometimes folks sit down to study for 45 minutes, but they're distracted by their cell phone or the TV, or it could just be that you don't have a quiet place in your house to study because there's children there. And so you're distracted, and you're really not getting the most out of your study time that you can. So when you have limited time, you need to try to find that quiet time, that quiet place where you can study and make sure that you stay focused so that you can actually concentrate. The other thing that I recommend is you have to look for those little short segments of time that you can study during the day. So maybe you ride the train to work, and so there's times you can study there. You can during your lunch hour, instead of going out with your peers from lunch every day of the week, maybe you do that one day a week while you're studying for the CPA exam, and the other days you bring a sandwich, and now you've got 45 minutes to an hour that you can focus on studying. And you actually get a whole lot more out of studying if you'll find short segments of time where you can work really hard for, say, 30 minutes and focus and concentrate, and then go do some other things and then come back and study for another 30 minutes later. And your brain's a muscle, and so it's just like going out and running. If you try to study 3-4 hours in a row, and once you've studied for an hour, hour and 15 minutes, your brain's just getting tired. So the other thing you want to do is you want to find, maybe 30 minutes before you go to work, 30 minutes before you go to bed, and you try to squeeze in 30, 45 minutes at lunch, and all of a sudden, you've studied an hour and a half a day, and it's not cutting into your personal life as much as it would if you weren't organized in that fashion.
Absolutely. No, I think that's great advice. And my wife and I, we did something very similar. We set up a calendar, and we just set up blocks of time where we were basically forced each other to hang out, and just, we'd schedule activities, and we were like, all right, for this hour and a half on Friday night, we're hanging out and we're not doing anything related to work or studying or anything like that.
Yeah, and it is important to make sure you do schedule that. Because you can get, burned out, and if you get burned out, then what happens is you're setting aside 2 hours to study, but but because you're burned out with it, now you're not studying smart. You're really exactly. Not getting the benefit out of it you would if you actually had a little more balance to your life.
All right. So, Greg, I guess my next question is, with your over 20 years of teaching experience, what advice can you give to students as they go through the process of deciding whether to start careers in audit, tax, or information systems? For me, it was, it was more of the unknown. I didn't know what audit was actually going to be like, and I didn't know what tax was actually going to be like. So I took each class and then kind of made my judgment from there. But is there anything else that students can be doing to help make that career decision?
They can. But before I mention some of those things that may be helpful in trying to make that career decision, let me mention one kind of broader point, which is, I don't think that if you're getting your accounting degree now or plan on doing that, don't put too much pressure on yourself in trying to make that determination of audit, tax, information systems, and even other types of career choices that are out there. An accounting curriculum at the undergraduate level is pretty much a broad-based curriculum that's giving you some exposure to all these areas. And then if you do get a master's degree in accounting, you may specialize somewhat, but unless you actually get a master's in taxation, which can be like 30 credit hours of tax, there you're still getting a pretty broad-based exposure. And the reason that's important is that if you start in one area and then you realize that you think you might enjoy another area better, if you are a good employee and you've been proceeding with your career in the way you should, you've been studying for the CPA exam, even if you don't have it all passed yet, you're passing parts of it, and your current employer or future employers can see that you're on track, there's going to be opportunities to make moves within an accounting career. One of the taglines the AICPA has used for accounting careers is there's 360 degrees of opportunity. And there's a lot of truth to that. With an accounting degree, you can go in lots of directions. Now, having said that, you'd still prefer to start off your career in an area that's a good fit for you. So what I would encourage, if you are at a university, what I would encourage you to do is get involved in the accounting student groups that are there, because they're bringing in speakers to campus who, some of them will be in audit, some will be in tax. You'll have some folks come in who may be in forensic accounting, folks who might be in careers, say, a little bit non-traditional careers, say, with law enforcement, the FBI, those types of things. So you can start to learn what the different career paths are. And then when you are, anytime that there's a firm or a company on campus and there's an opportunity to interact with them. I try to take advantage of that, and don't just sit in the audience and listen to what's saying. Get there early, stay late, introduce yourself to some of the folks who are there from the employer who's presenting, and you'll be surprised at how much you'll learn over time about some of the different career paths. The other thing, if you can, is you definitely would like to, you know, it's good to do an internship, because that's like a 3-month interview, and you may do an internship in audit and find that you just didn't enjoy audit, and so when you actually look for that full-time job, you may want to do it in the tax route. I can tell you for myself, I mentioned earlier that during my senior year at Lipscomb University, I worked part-time, 20 hours a week or so, for a local CPA firm, and didn't do much audit, did a little bit of audit with them, but did a lot of tax. And at the same time, it's during my senior year, I was taking my auditing course and my tax course. And I just realized through that opportunity that I thought I enjoyed tax more than audit. And I always have. You know, I've always loved doing tax. You know, I never know. I mean, if I'd start off in audit, maybe I would have enjoyed it more. And that's kind of what I'm saying about, you know, don't put too much pressure on the decision. Try to make the best informed decision you can based on your, you know, ultimately it kind of comes down to a gut feeling about what you think you would enjoy the most. And then do your best. And as long as you're working hard and doing well in your career, you'll have opportunities to move to different areas if you decide you want to do that later.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that that's something that I saw a lot in the corporate world, was that people would get so stuck on being in one section and they just felt like they were trapped, when in reality, all you have to do is just ask, and then you can switch your career path or even switch jobs into something that you'd be more interested in. And I think it's dangerous if you don't make that move, because if you're unhappy, then you're not being a good asset for the company, and then the company is going to notice that. And so,
yeah.
One
other thing, Brian, is just, you know, if you're very uncertain, that there probably is, it's probably a little safer if to go into the audit area, whether it's in public accounting or say you go into the internal audit area with a large company. But you do learn a lot in auditing. You really get exposure to the whole company, and that is experience that's going to serve you well, no matter what you end up doing. Also, there's usually more jobs in auditing, because entry level positions, because there's just more demand in that area. So if you're really unsure, auditing is definitely a great way to start. But if the opportunity that comes your way is a information systems opportunity, then it may be something to try and see how it works for you.
Sure. And this is just a personal question for me, just from what I noticed when I was in college, is that there was a huge push to go into public accounting right out of college. So personally, like, I was let go from my first job due to the economy, because I started work August of 2008, which was possibly the worst timing ever. And so I went from working a year at a public accounting firm into the private industry, and I really felt that I learned a ton about accounting and how a company works. And then once I got my CPA, then I worked for the Big Four firm, and then I just felt like I was a much better auditor, because I totally understood the transactions I was looking at, and I felt like it was a better career path to start in private and then go into public. But what I was just curious what your thoughts were on that.
Well, it's changed a great deal in the last 30 years. Now, 30 years ago, and I guess I came out of that's about the time I was coming out of undergrad. The thinking then was, the advice that college professors gave their students was, if you can go public accounting, of course back then it was the Big Eight firms, not the Big Four that we have today, but especially, you know, if you could go with a Big Eight firm, that's definitely what you wanted to do, because moving from industry back into public accounting, particularly with the large firms, was very unusual. But over the last 30 years, that has changed significantly, and it hasn't changed just recently. I mean, I think as much as certainly 15 years ago, it's now a trend started that's different from that. And now the case is, I have the opportunity to interact with some of the leaders in recruiting and human resources with the Big Four firms. And if you look at the number of individuals they hire each year off of college campuses, and then compare that to the number of individuals that they're hiring into experience levels, I think it's approximately the same. And so it's no longer the case where you cannot move from industry into public accounting. And so really, I think coming out of school, I encourage students to go the route that they feel the most comfortable with. And if they start off in industry, it's like I said just a moment ago, when we were comparing different areas of accounting, same thing goes with industry type. If you're in industry and you're doing a good job, you're networking well, you've joined some professional associations where you're meeting folks from public accounting firms as well as with other industrial positions in the area that you live in, and you want to make a career move, accounting's always been a profession where there's lots of job opportunities for those who are willing to work hard and do a good job. And so I think it's fine these days to start off in industry, and then if you decide you want to move into public accounting later, that's something that you'll be able to do. Even with the larger firms, you know, if a larger firm is, even if a Big Four firm, you know, if say in a particular location, they have lost several people in a particularly industry segment, say banking and financial services, and you've got 5 to 8 years of experience in that type of company, you're going to be very attractive to them. If, and this is a big if, you know, if you have the CPA, if you're going into a public accounting firm and you're going to be in the accounting side of it, auditing and tax and related areas to that, you need that professional certification. It's critical that you have that. We had a student from University of North Alabama just about, 2 years ago, I guess, who left here and took a job with it was in the governmental sector, and I wasn't sure the student would enjoy that long term. I thought they would want more of a challenge than that, but for certain reasons, the student felt like that was the best thing to do. And about 6 months ago, I got a call from a firm up in Tennessee who was needing to hire somebody in their auditing department and wanted to know if I had any suggestions. Well, this guy came to mind, and I checked with him, and he had passed 3 parts of the exam, had taken the 4th part, and was waiting to get the results on part 4. And about 10 days later, he had an offer from this large accounting firm in Tennessee. And so getting that exam passed and having that on your resume, that's going to help you be very mobile throughout your career.
Absolutely. Yeah, I totally agree. Okay, well, the great thing about having my own podcast is that I have the ability to have people on my show who are truly successful at what they do. And I think it's very important that us as the less experienced people try to emulate some of the habits of these people who have more experience and more knowledge than ourselves. So I always try to ask some rapid-fire questions to the people that I interview to help the listeners understand what it is that makes you successful.
Sure.
So I guess my first question is, as a successful CPA and PhD, what does your morning routine look like? You know, how do you get ready to tackle the day?
Well, I can say that my morning routine probably looks a lot different now that I'm a dean than it did when I was in a regular full-time faculty position. But in terms of what my morning routine looks like, before I started as dean, I was more diligent at getting exercise in the morning before my day started. I still am able to do that sometimes, but not as much as I was before I took on the additional responsibilities of the dean's role. And really, you know, as I'm looking at trying to get ready for a business day, I really try to do that just before I go to bed the night before. And so I try to make sure that I've reviewed my calendar, make sure I know what meetings that I have to do, and then make sure I've got the preparations in place that I need for those. In a regular faculty role, and academia is a great career. I would encourage any of your listeners who think they might be interested in academia to talk with some of the professors that they know from their academic days and get some advice from them. But in a regular faculty role, you know, you're teaching and you're providing service to the profession and to the business community. You're involved in research, but also, you know, the you're interacting with students and you're helping encourage students and mentor students, and that's a great part of the job. But to be honest, as a dean, I think probably just about every day of the week, it may not be the first thing in the morning, but you know, sometime before lunch, there's usually something that comes up that was unexpected that has to be dealt with, and so your day is your day's not quite as well structured as it is in a regular faculty position.
Right. Well, I'd say the same can be said of any position, like especially in auditing. It just felt like there was always fires popping up that we had to put out. So, you know, something that I found to be successful in your career, and especially studying to pass the CPA exam, that productivity and the ability to stay focused are just so crucial. So what with all these new distractions like email, social media, cell phones, TV, and so forth, it's just getting harder and harder to accomplish this. So what do you do to stay focused and productive?
Well, you're right in that it is harder to do today, and it's so easy to be distracted. You also can multitask, though, at times. And so you may be sitting in a meeting, and it's not a meeting with three or four people where you need to be extremely engaged in the discussion. It may be a meeting with 20 folks. And if you have an electronic device there with you, you might actually be able to clear some email depending on what the purpose of the meeting is and your level of required engagement. So what I try to do in terms of trying to stay focused and productive is make sure that I have clearly thought out exactly what the task is I'm working on. And there are times that I'm working on something that really needs a lot of my concentration. And if that's the case, I want to be in a quiet environment. Whether I'm at work or at home, I make sure that I get myself in a quiet environment where there's not any distractions so I can really stay focused on what I'm doing. There's other times, though, where I'm working on some things that maybe even at the house, and I'm in my den and the TV's on and it's kind of just on for background. But with what I'm working on, to be honest, it's a little relaxing just to be able to knock a few. Maybe I'm just clearing some email, but you know, I can interact with my wife. I can, you know, have a football game on TV or something like that at the same time. So my point really is you can't be 100% focused all the time. And you just not enough mental energy to do that. So I think you really need to think about when is it that you're working on something that really requires that extreme focus and attention, and make sure you do that. Make sure you're being responsible enough to give it that. And then other times, you know, tone it back just a little bit. So that you're still getting some things done you need to get done during the night or during the day or during the evening, but it doesn't require the same level of attention.
What are your thoughts on listening to music while studying for the CPA exam? Do you think that helps or can it be detrimental?
In my opinion, I would think that it would always be detrimental. Now, if my children were listening to me now, I don't know if they would agree or disagree, but. And they're either in college or out of college now. I do know that, you know, this generation, the way they've grown up with media, and it was very different from how I grew up, that they're much more accustomed to having several different mediums going on at the same time. So they may be listening to music and they may be responding to a text message at the same time that they're writing a paper, or as you said, studying for the CPA exam. But I just know from my own experience, and you know, I've always enjoyed academia, and I've always applied myself to the task in academia when I was a student, and so I had some success there. But for me to really do my best, I had to be able to really focus and concentrate. So I really think if folks are listening to music or picking their cell phone up every 3 or 4 minutes, my opinion is I really think they're not getting the most out of their study time as they have. And listen, if you have unlimited time to study and you don't have these competing demands we talked about earlier, it may be a more relaxed, interesting way to study. But most folks don't have that luxury. Most folks are under the gun to get that exam passed. It's something their employer wants them to do, or they know they got to get it passed in order to make that move, career move that they want to make, to position themselves better for their life. And like I said earlier, if you're studying for 45 minutes get the most you can out of that 45 minutes, and you don't do that with listening to music.
Yeah, I agree. I definitely agree. For me personally, I did not listen to music that had voice in it, so I would listen to soundtracks from like Gladiator and the Rocky soundtrack. I personally think that soundtrack is the reason I'm a CPA today, just getting me pumped up.
Yeah, well, to have some background atmosphere certainly can help folks, I think, and probably for your generation that they probably enjoy that more than my generation mm-hmm. would.
Sure, you know, I know that you're very passionate about academia, and so when you did decide to become a PhD in, or I guess my question is, when did you decide to become a PhD and focus on teaching? And then also, what do you recommend to people considering this option in accounting?
I really didn't think about it too much until I was in my master's program at the University of Memphis. I began thinking about it some, but really not seriously. And so then I started working with Ernst, and I enjoyed my job with Ernst. I worked in the tax department in Nashville, Tennessee, and it wasn't that I was trying to get away from something I didn't enjoy. I was doing well. But I had the opportunity to teach in more in an informal context several times sort of throughout my life, whether it was something that was church-related or it was tutoring. I even did some tutoring in high school, but did quite a bit of tutoring during my master's program as a graduate assistant at the University of Memphis. And really just discovered that I really just enjoy trying to communicate more complex topics to individuals, and when you could see the light bulb go on for them, it was just something that I really enjoyed. So it was, while I was working at Ernst, I decided that it was something that I thought I wanted to do, and I began doing the research to find out more about what a PhD is all about and the commitment that it would take and the things I needed to do to prepare myself to be admitted to a good PhD program. If folks are considering that option, the number one thing I would recommend they do is they need to talk to other accounting faculty, because the accounting academia is extremely different than the business world. Getting a PhD in accounting, really the only reason you do that is that you want to go into academia. The things that you learn there are very important, and they're very worthwhile if you want to be in academia, but they're really not things that are going to give you a tremendous amount of additional value added if you say go back into public accounting or go back into industry. So it is something you need to learn as much as you can about. The other mistake that some folks make in looking at PhD programs is they assume all PhD programs are pretty similar, because that's been their experience with undergrad and master's programs. So you could look at the top five ranked master's programs in the country, and then you could just pick five master's of accounting programs at random. If you look at the curriculums, now there's going to be some differences, but for the most part, they're going to be pretty similar. They're most going to be about 30, 33 credit hours, those types of things. But it's not that way with PhD programs. They vary significantly from one university to another. In terms of the amount of coursework required, the amount of time it takes to get the degree, and even in terms of the focus, there are some very good accounting PhD programs out there that just don't have any tax specialist on their faculty who can really help a doctoral student mentor a doctoral student in the tax area, and so those are things you have to look at to be careful with. I do think that you know, it's a very rewarding career. As deans usually don't teach, and I've been a dean for this time being a dean at University of North Alabama. It's been about a year and a half now, and I've continued to teach at least one class a semester. Occasionally, I'll actually teach two, and I just really enjoy being in the classroom, and I enjoy interacting with the students, helping them learn. And there's no doubt that the thing I enjoy the most is when one of our students has landed a really good position. And, you know, they've worked hard. We've worked hard on from the faculty side to help prepare them for the career. And it all comes together, and they just land a great opportunity. and that can be life changing for a student. And so that's what's great about academia. I feel like you really have an opportunity to make a difference in people's lives, and it gets you excited about getting up in the morning and doing your job.
Sure. No, thank you so much for sharing. That was very insightful. Thank you so much for giving us an inside look into your career, Greg. I really appreciate it. And so as an employee of Wiley CPAexcel, I have a great opportunity to ask you some questions that I think many of the listeners may be wondering about Wiley CPAexcel, especially if they're on the fence about whether CPAexcel is the right course for them. So if you don't mind, I would like to ask you a few questions about the course.
Sure, that's fine.
So what do you think that Wiley CPAexcel is doing in the CPA review course industry that no one else is doing?
Well, there's several things I think that they do better than anyone else, and then there are also some things they're doing that I just don't think anybody else in the industry has caught up to yet. In terms of what makes this CPAexcel product unique, there's a few factors that all come together to make a really great product. First of all is that the authors are all full-time faculty members. And, you know, I've been teaching for about 25 years now. And I can tell you that today when I'm in the classroom, I understand a whole lot better how to communicate to my students in a way that's going to give them the best opportunity to understand it than I did, you know, when I first started teaching. It's just like anything else in life. The more you do it, the better you should get at that. And so the folks who are preparing the materials and doing the video lectures in CPAexcel, they're doing this every semester. Every week they're in the classroom. They have students in their offices where they're helping them with issues. So the other thing that means is that they're also subject matter experts. So, I mean, tax is my area. If they asked me to prepare some material in financial accounting, you know, I could do it. I'd have to, you know, have to spend a whole lot of time getting ready for that, but I could do it. But there's no way I'm going to do that as well as the folks at CPAexcel, who that's what their specialty area is. Just like if somebody asked them to come in and do tax, there's no way they could get caught up to the 25 years of experience that I have teaching tax. So that's one of the things. One of the other key distinctives is that the material is organized in what's called bite-sized lessons. Earlier I talked about that, you know, you get a whole lot more out of studying. If you'll study for an hour, sit down for an hour five times, you're going to learn a whole lot more than you do if you sit down one time for 5 hours. And the material, the way it's arranged in CPAexcel, lends itself to sitting down for shorter periods of time and actually mastering a concept, then taking a break and then coming back to the next concept. Another item that is definitely, I believe, best in the industry is just the technology. CPAexcel started as an internet-based CPA review program. The underlying software that's really the that is the system that is still used today. When that was developed, it wasn't really even developed with a CPAexcel course in mind. It was developed for instructional technology. And then a marriage sort of took place between this instructional technology product and CPAexcel materials. And if you look at most of the other competing products in the marketplace, these are products that were designed to be done with books or designed actually to be done in classrooms. And over time, they've tried to conform those products to fit into the internet. But it's kind of like putting, you know, a square peg in a round hole. And so the technology advances that CPAexcel has to make the learning experience very rich is very unique. And the last thing I'll mention, which I think is just a fantastic commitment that CPAexcel makes to those who want to pass a CPA exam, is the partner until you pass guarantee. You know, once you buy CPAexcel, you're guaranteed to get all updates and continue to get access to the material until you pass the CPA exam. And you know, the tax law changes every year. And if you bought CPAexcel 5 years ago and you really haven't put the time in yet to pass the exam and you're still, you know, that's still a go of yours, well, when I do my updates for the tax law, actually the the updates for 2014 are in there now. You'll have access to those, even though you bought the course 5 years ago. And there's no other product out there that will actually partner with the CPA candidate until they pass the exam and let them have access to all that updated material. And not just updated material, but course enhancements. You know, CPAExcel is enhancing the software every year to make it a better learning experience.
Sure. Yeah, I those are some great features that definitely aren't offered anywhere else. So Wiley CPAExcel has three primary products. They've got the silver, the gold medal, and the platinum. So for students who are fresh out of college, which review course option do you think is best for them?
Brian, I think in terms of which product is the best, if you're right out of school, I think you have to look more, you really need to look somewhat introspectively and see how you learn the best. The major difference between the platinum product and the gold product gets back to the merger of CPAExcel and Wiley that happened almost 2 years ago now. You know, Wiley had the, you know, if you go back to pre-internet days, Wiley had the number one CPA review manual in the world for many, many years. Their paper-based review manual for the CPA exam. It's what I studied out of back when I took the exam back in, I guess it was 1984 when I passed the CPA exam. And so when Wiley bought CPAExcel and brought those all that expertise together, one of the great benefits to that now is that in addition to all of the questions, multiple choice questions and task-based simulations that have always been in the CPAExcel product, it brings all of the question bank from Wiley that have been developed over several decades. And the students can have access to all of that if they buy the platinum product. Whether they need the platinum or the gold, the difference in the gold is with the gold they don't have access to the online question bank that from the Wiley product, but they do have access to all of the material that's always been part of CPAExcel. And I think that gets back a little bit to how you learn. And what I mean by that is that, you know, do you learn the best by working problems? And for most students, that's the case. And if you learn the best by working problems, then I'd recommend you to buy the product that gives you the access to the most problems. Because, you know, will you work every problem in the material? No, you don't have time to do that. But as you're going, say, through the tax material, you may discover that depreciation recapture is something that's just hard for you to grasp, and you really need more practice with that. So if you have access to all of these questions in these databases, you can find, you know, several questions on depreciation recapture that you can go in and work. And what I always tell students in my own courses at the university and with the CPA exam is when you're sitting down on the exam, what are you going to be doing? You're going to be working problems, and you're going to be working problems that you do not have the solution to. So when you're preparing for the CPA exam, if you want to get good at that, you have to do the same thing. You have to work the problem yourself, which is different from reading a problem and then reading a solution. And that's a mistake a lot of folks make when they're preparing for an academic exam at the university or the CPA exam. I always compare this to basketball. If someone has never played basketball and decides they want to be a great basketball player, you know, they could buy some books about basketball and the fundamentals of basketball and read them. They could watch a lot of college and pro basketball games on TV and learn a lot about it. They could spend a year doing that, and then they step on the court the first time, and they think they're going to do well, and, of course, they're not because they've never actually played basketball before. The only way you get good at playing basketball is to practice basketball. The only way you get good at solving problems is to solve the problem yourself. And that's different from watching a professor solve a solution on a blackboard. It's different than reading the solution to a problem in the CPAExcel materials. So I would encourage students to get access to as many problems as they can and then actually work the problems themselves and then check the solution so they can discover you know, what that kind of missing link was in the problems that they missed that they wouldn't have got without seeing the solution. In terms of the silver product, one of the main differences in the silver product and the gold product is that the gold product has access to subject matter experts, which I do serve in that role for the tax materials. So with the gold and the platinum product, as candidates for the exam or going through the reg material, if they have a question about anything in the tax material, they can post a question to me and I will get them an answer back within 24 hours. So you do have that one-on-one mentoring that some students find really helpful when they're going through the material.
Sure, sure. Yeah, and I agree. It's all about muscle memory when it comes to taking multiple choice questions, because there are patterns within the questions themselves. So the more questions you do, the more likely you are to recognize what type of question it is.
Exactly.
Sure. So, and I guess the same advice, it probably applies to people who've been out of college for several years as well. Which of the three do you think would most work for those type of people who have been out of college?
Yeah, I mean, there I think it's more likely that the platinum is going to, the extra price for the platinum is going to provide additional value to them. And once again, the reason for that is just because they have been out of school for a while, those problem-solving skills, especially in a testing environment, get a little bit rusty. And so sure. The more problems that you actually have to work, the better off you're going to be. For a student who just wrapped up their master's program and they've been in academia for 5 years, their test-taking skills are in pretty good shape. And so for them, that's why I was saying it's just really a matter of how they prefer to study, more in terms of working more problems or spending more time in the study text and the videos. But I think for the folks who it's been a while since they've been out of school, getting access to the maximum number of questions they can, they'll probably find to be helpful for them.
Good. Well, Greg, I want to be very cognizant of your time. I know you got a lot on your plate with the semester in full swing, but before I let you go, I just want to let our listeners know about the big Wiley CPAexcel scholarship giveaway that will be given occurring on October 31st, 2014. I believe I'll be giving away a gold medal video review course. So for those of you interested, please visit www.thecpaguide.com/scholarship.html to register. All you have to do to register to win the scholarship is to sign up for the CPA Guide newsletter, and then leave a comment in the discussion box about what you plan to do with your CPA review bucks once you pass the CPA exam. So for me personally, I passed the CPA exam back in 2010, so my books were just sitting there, and I had no idea what to do with them. Well, my family and I, we decided to train to take a 25-mile hike out in Glacier National Park in Montana. So let me tell you, having that extra 15 to 20 pounds of books in my hiking backpack while training here in the flatlands of Missouri made all the difference when I was climbing the mile-high mountains of Montana. And if we had run into a bear on the trail, well, let's just say I wouldn't have been the slowest person out of our group. So hurry up and visit thecpaguide.com/scholarship.html and leave your comment before midnight on October 31st, 2014. And check out my How to Train for a Hike with Your CPA Exam review books. And Dr. Carnes, I just wanted to thank you again for sharing all of your advice, and I know that it's going to help countless listeners. So at this point, did you have anything else you'd like to add?
Okay, Brian, I think that's all I got.
All right. Thank you, sir, and have a great day.
Okay, good to meet you.
If you want more of the CPA Guide podcast, you can subscribe on iTunes, or you can go to thecpaguide.com for even more great content about how to pass the CPA exam.
This podcast is only for general advice. It should not be construed as accounting, legal, or any other professional advice. Your particular situation is fact-dependent, and you are recommended to seek the help of a competent professional.